What's up, ballers? Boom, the Z-Man coming live and direct from Omaha, Nebraska with the Sit Down Zumock podcast. Thanks for listening. Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for leaving a review on iTunes. Thanks for signing up on the Patreon. Hell yeah. And I want to give a shout out to Brendan and Steve from Omaha. Came out to the show because of Patreon. They're signed up, and I appreciate that. If you want to sign up for my Patreon, just go to patreon.com/sitdownzumock, and you can sign up for the rewards. There's all kinds of tiers. A $3 Gunner Club pretty much gets you what you want, but there's all kinds of cool shit in there, like tickets to shows, shirts, bracelets, stickers are coming. I got all kinds of stuff. Check it out, man. I know money's tight for a lot of people. You know, the economy's doing really well right now, but everyone's signed up for a subscription service like YouTube Red, Netflix, iTunes Music. But $3 a month is nothing. And I throw up stuff on there that I don't put out in public. I don't put it on Instagram. I don't put it on Facebook. It's just stuff I find. Like, there's a rare interview with Patrice O'Neill from my old radio show. There's a rare video of Jim Norton in studio with us from 2010. And I just put it up there just so it could have a life and so the Patreon people are rewarded. I'll be doing some more video content. I'm doing all kinds of stuff. I'm trying to keep it all out there. So check it out. $3 a month, it's nothing if you can help me out. Because right now I am a one-man operation. I do all the production. I do everything. And it's a little time-consuming. And I'd like to get it to the point where I have a producer. I could get some more production done. Hopefully get a co-host, a video component. And it requires a lot of effort, man. I wish I could delegate this, but I'm not in the position. But I know people are listening because I get your emails. People are coming up to me after shows, and I do appreciate that. So $3 Gunner Club, check it out. And there's all kinds. You get $10, $20, $100 gets you a sponsor on the show, a little 30-second read. And my man, Kevin Cernier, he is a State Farm agent. He serves all of Ohio. I'm talking the whole goddamn state. And I don't know if you deal with insurance or if you dealt with insurance, but it's a fucking nightmare. When I got my car wreck, I didn't have an insurance agent. And Geico, those pieces of shit, all those fucking... If you know anyone who works at Geico, I'm talking the president, all the way down to the janitor, to the accounts payable, you're a bunch of fucking shitheads. You made my life hell. And I wish I had Kevin on my side at the time to take care of all of that shit. You know, hit him up. Hit him up directly if you live in Ohio. Because I swear to God, it's a nightmare if you get in a car wreck. Anything with your fucking car. You're on the phone all goddamn day. It's just a mess. Call him. 330-877-2323. I'm going to put the link in the description of this podcast. Or you can go to his website, kevincernier.com. It's right in the description. If you're on the fence about insurance or if your policy is about to expire and you want to move on to a better rate, let an expert deal with it. Let him deal with it. Don't go through the nonsense I had to go through. All right, this week's episode. Before we get to this week's episode, I'm at the Chicago Improv all this week with Godfrey. I'll be there 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. And I have a feeling Godfrey will be on next week's podcast. So come out to the Schaumburg Chicago Improv. If you're in the Chicago area, you want to come, sign up for the Patreon because you can get tickets, free tickets to the show. We'll throw you on the VIP list, meet and greet. You can meet Godfrey. It'll be a fun, fun time. This week's episode is with comedian Brad Williams. If you were just in Omaha, shout out to everyone in Omaha. I'm starting to get a fan base in Omaha from performing here and doing the Todd and Tyler morning show. Shout out Todd and Tyler. People are coming out to see me. It's pretty cool getting recognized at the store just from Todd and Tyler. So, yeah, we had a great week. Brad Williams is a guy I've known for a long time, but I never knew him. I just knew of him. We have mutual friends. So we finally connected this week. We hit it off. He's a great comic, man. He's a real fucking funny dude. He puts in the work. He can turn over a room. I had a great time with him. We have a great discussion. We talk about comedy. We talk about Barry Katz. We talk about other comedians. We gossip like comedians do. And we put it out there for a good hour episode. I hope you enjoy it. Follow Brad. Pick up his specials. He's a funny motherfucker. If you see him coming to a comedy club, and he's always coming to a comedy club, at all times. He's either coming or going. It's worth a night out in the town to see him, so check him out. Great guy, too. So let's get this thing started, all right? That's a wrap!
Sit down, Zumock.
Sit down, Zumock.
I've got at least one pair of good shoes in the back of the closet somewhere.
I'm an American. I am. I come from a family with a proud, strong American tradition. My grandfather served in World War II. My dad served in Vietnam. And I served at Applebee's, so... bunch of bullshit.
Man, I don't even, there's no prep, nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing, just dive right in.
Well, it is what, called King of Stupid?
King of Stupid, I'm a dummy.
So why would you do any prep? Why it's the King of Stupid, let's just go with the theme.
Yeah.
I'm not expecting you to have notes, you know, nothing like that. Like, all right, I got my notes here. So it says in 2002, like, no, I just figure you jump right in.
I'm going to go Walter Cronkite, sit down. And really get to know the depths of the great Brad Williams. Thanks for doing the podcast, dude.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me on. I'm doing this podcast because you're opening for me in Omaha, Nebraska at the Omaha Funny Bone. If you came to the shows, thank you. If you didn't, fuck you. where were you? No. But I'm doing this because we're in Omaha for a few days.
And yeah.
What the hell else am I gonna do?
I know.
Podcast, why not? And I would love for your eight listeners to suddenly become fans of mine. So that's
nine.
You got up to nine. Impressive, man.
No, I got a nice, because you know we talked about this on Todd and Tyler, the morning show here in Omaha. Yeah. We both did radio, so I got a nice little collectively little fan base from doing radio all those years.
Nice.
In Cleveland, Ohio. So I got a pretty loyal base.
All right, Cleveland. If you're one of those bases and you're in Cleveland, I'm coming to Hilarities in 2019. I think my birthday weekend, January 10th.
I was there when you got the email.
Yeah, I was very excited.
Because we always made the joke that you and Jim Florentine were the white comics that did the Cleveland Improv.
That's right, dude.
Come on.
That's right, guy. It was just me and Brad Williams. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're the last white guys that can still do that role. You know, it's a great club, but, you know, there's a lot of, urban audience that comes out there. Yeah. Yeah, I was sort of the last white guy standing at that club. But, no, I'm excited to go back and do Hilarities. I've been there before. With other comics.
Yeah.
I remember Steve Byrne brought me in there one time, and Orny Adams brought me in there one time, and just kind of look around, and we hung out, and it's a great club. So I'm really excited, and I'll be doing that one, like I said, my birthday weekend, January 10th through the 13th.
I was emceeing for Sebastian Maniscalco at the – you remember when the Cleveland Improv was in the Powerhouse?
Yeah.
When it was like kind of – it was a cool place. The ceilings were low. And – I go, you got to see Hilarity, Sebastian. Let me take you over there.
Yeah.
From day one, the comedy club, you're going to meet him, Nick, the owner.
Yeah.
Fell in love with Sebastian, became the club favorite.
Yeah.
And now he's doing theaters.
And now he's doing theaters and stadiums and making $25 million a year. So I'm not going to say Hilarity is directly responsible. But,
yeah.
Yeah, well done. Well, hopefully I get the same bump.
Yeah.
Hopefully I do Hilarities and within 5 years I'm making $25 million a year, because that'd be great.
That'd be great for anyone.
I'm telling you right now, if I ever make $25 million in a year, the next year you will never see me.
Touring?
I'll tour.
Yeah.
But I don't have a motor like some of these guys do, where like a Chris Hardwick, where you got a talk show, a podcast, producing, hosting a game show, and you're still doing stand-up dates.
Yeah.
Like, I don't have that in me. Like, I've got enough to do, like, stand-up. And maybe stand up. Like right now, I have stand up in my podcast.
Yeah.
That's what I have.
That's a good workload.
Yeah. My dad always taught me when I was a kid, he's like, you have time in your life to do three things well. So pick your three things. You know, you could. So.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So, like, my dad, his three things were he was a lawyer, he'd be a father, and he would play golf. That's what he had time to do. That's what he did. You know, so like when I hear these people, like you and I have been watching Shark Tank the last week before the shows. When you hear these people that are like, all right, I'm a dermatologist and I teach a spin class 3 days a week.
Yeah.
And now this is my startup business. I'm like, fuck you. No, do one of those. Do one. That and for those who do 9,000 jobs, hey man, God bless you. Good for you, because I can't do that. So if I ever have a Sebastian Maniscalco year where I make $25 million, unless I got a TV show that employs a lot of people that I would feel bad walking away from, I'd be like, all right, I'm good.
Yeah,
I can live off $25 million.
I'm naturally a lazy guy. I'm a pretty lazy guy.
Because it's fun to be lazy.
It is.
Man, I tell you, and especially when you're a comic and you're on the road and you hear all these things that your friends that have normal jobs are doing on their weekends.
Yeah.
Like, they're like, hey, it's the weekend. We're going to go to this concert, or we're going to this festival, or we're going to Vegas for the week.
Right.
You're like, oh, yeah, I'm in Omaha, so I got to do shows because that's how I pay my mortgage.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, it'd be great to just do nothing and figure out when the hell people are coming out. You know, like what the hell people are doing in your town. Oh, my God. Like, I'm friends with Adam Devine, and he just bought a beach house in Newport Beach, and we were there for Fourth of July. And it's
I remember that fucker was a server.
Yeah.
Buying it.
Yeah. Now he's got a $3 million beach house in Newport. And it's amazing. And I looked at my wife and I was like, if I ever get enough money to buy this house, I'm just not leaving.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna stay in this house and be like, great, here's the water, there's my little private beach, here's my little dinghy boat. I'm happy. That's it. I'm done.
It's hard. I mean, you've been doing this, what, 15 years now?
Yeah, right, 15 years.
Right, the same.
Yeah, I started when I was 19. I'm 34 now. Yeah, in October, it'll be 16.
It's becoming more of a mind fuck now that I hit 40 that I'm watching my friends get famous and rich.
Yeah.
And I'm doing the same thing. I'm not jealous. I'm like happy. Go, you know, have fun, Sebastian. Yeah. But
obviously, and you watch Sebastian, you're like, yeah, you're really fucking good at this.
Yeah.
My manager, Barry Katz, has this phrase where he just says...
Is that your manager right now?
Yeah, man, I've got Barry Katz as my manager. And he tells me, he goes, you gotta be undeniable, man. And that's what Sebastian is. He's undeniable. Because
that's a good Barry.
Yeah, if you know Barry, that is what he sounds like. And he's undeniable. Where Sebastian makes those theaters full of people laugh. So you can't say, and he sells the tickets. So you can't say that he doesn't deserve it, or he's not worth it.
Yeah.
Obviously he is. And he's funny as hell.
Yeah.
So, but it's really strange. I was talking to my friend about this the other day. It's really strange where comedy is one of those things where, you can do the same activity for thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
Or for no dollars. And it just depends.
Yeah.
And not even on your status. Because, like, I'll do a show this weekend and make whatever, $1,000, whatever it is, like, that, you know, for that show. And then I'll do a corporate gig where I'll do the same hour and it's worth 10 times as
much.
And then I'll go to the Comedy Store and do a set there and get paid $25.
Yeah.
Like, it's this crazy thing that comedy is, that you do it, you know, and Jerry Seinfeld will do a set at Caesars, make $100,000, and then he'll pop into the cellar and do 20 minutes for nothing.
Yeah.
So it's just like, it's really weird about...
Or even colleges. Like, if you do a college, you know, I'm at, you know, $3,500 or whatever, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And now just... Yeah, and then you do a set somewhere else, and you get paid $100.
Right,
like it's a little crazy because you don't know what you're worth when people say, like, all right, so how much, if I want to book you, how much am, you know, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I know.
How much can you pay me? Because I literally don't know. Maybe am I free that day? And also, it's really hard even for me now making decent money. it's hard to be home and someone calls and says, hey, do you want to do my room or my show or whatever? And I go, how much does it pay? And they say, I can pay you $100 or $150. It's hard for me to turn that down.
Yeah.
Because it's, in my head, I go, ooh, that's a phone bill.
Yeah.
Like, ooh, that's a cable bill. Like, that's just one night doing... doing.
Plus, when you're younger, that was like, fuck, $100?
Yeah, exactly. And
you're first
still,
starting out?
I'm still in that mindset.
Yeah.
Like, what? You're paying me to do this?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I still go and I'll say yes to a lot of those gigs for that reason.
Yeah. Then you have to give Barry 20% of that $100.
Hey, that's right, man, because I got you a great room in Santa Monica. It's 15 people, but it's a wonderful room. They'll give you two drinks. I get one of those drinks. Damn it, Barry.
Who's he represent now? Who's on his roster? Dane's not with him anymore, is he?
No, Dane's not with him. Dave Chappelle's no longer with him. Like, he's one of those guys where you name anyone. And, like, who's your favorite comic in the business? Is Jim Brewer your favorite? Cool. He represented him. Was Louis C.K. your favorite?
Yeah.
He represented him. Dane Cook, Dave Chappelle. Like, it goes on and on and on. And now
Brad Williams.
That's funny, man. Is Whitney still with him?
No. Whitney Cummings was with him for a while. So
yeah,
everyone's with him at some point, and then everyone leaves him at some point. So
and right now you're with him.
Right now I'm with him. So you'll know I'm really doing well when I leave him.
That means something happened. Something big happened. Well, you have a podcast with Adam Ray. It's called
About Last Night.
Yeah, which you subscribe to and all, you know, wherever you get this podcast.
Yeah, and even if you're like, well, I don't know, I listen to too many podcasts, just subscribe to it. That helps us.
Yeah.
And delete the fucker every time it pops up in your phone. I don't give a shit. Just subscribe to us, because it really helps us out, and you'll probably see some episodes that you want to listen to anyway. Like, we just had an amazing run, man. We had... in the last, like, month and a half, we've had Bill Burr.
I have that queued.
Yeah, we've had Bill Burr. We've had Jim Jeffries. We had Eliza Schlesinger. We did a live one with Lonnie Love at the Montreal Comedy Festival.
Oh, I love her. She's great.
And this comes out on Tuesday?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Then the episode this week is Maria Menounos.
Oh, okay.
Who we got to record at her house. And, wow, she may have my favorite house I've ever been in.
Really?
It's amazing.
Where does she live?
She lives in Encino, California, and it's ridiculous. It's just this ultimate, you know, tennis court.
She's done well for herself.
Yeah, tennis court, basketball court, an amazing pool, this barbecue set. There's a fucking orchard.
Orchard?
Yeah.
In L.A.?
Well, like, it's not, you know, yeah, not acres, but, you know, there's some trees. She gave me some lemons. So it's nice. I saw that and I'm like, fuck, how hard do I gotta work to
see? That's what I'm saying, like, at the beginning of the conversation, like, you see, you know, it's just like, whoa, I just want a little bit of that. I don't not a lot,
just a little bit of that. Hey, man, I thought I bought a house and I put a putting green in my backyard, and for me that's like, yeah.
That's good,
in
man.
In my backyard, I got a putting green and a fire pit, and I'm like, this is the best. I don't have to do anything else.
For telling jokes, so at the end of the...
telling jokes.
Yeah.
It's pretty nuts when you think about that. Like, yeah, it's nuts when you look at a guy like Sebastian or a Russell Peters or, you know, these guys that are making... you know, Jeff Dunham, that are, you know, they're making $10 million, $20 million.
Yeah.
It's tough to imagine that, but even if you make $125,000 a year telling jokes,
yeah,
you make $70,000 a year. Really? $70,000 a year telling jokes?
Yeah.
That's insane. Like, because people understand, like, this is a weird job, because in the corporate world, as you move up, you get more responsibility.
Yeah.
Okay. The manager has more responsibility than, you know, the guy, the secretary, than the door person, then you move up from manager.
Right.
Now you're the executive vice president, and that has more responsibility, and the CEO has more like as you move up, there's more responsibility. Comedy, as you get paid, like, you're doing the same shit. You're doing the same thing.
Nothing's changed.
I mean, you run more of your business. That changes.
Yeah.
But in terms of the actual thing that you get paid for, yeah, it's the same shit. Jerry Seinfeld and Dave Chappelle do the exact same thing that you and I do. Go on a stage and make people laugh. They get paid, you know, millions of dollars to do it, but they're doing the exact same thing, and they do the exact same thing we do when they go up at the clubs and just try.
Yeah.
You know?
But going back to being undeniable,
undeniable,
I mean.
Undeniable,
man. So they have that. There's a lot of people who can get on that stage and tell those jokes, but like, who are the ones that stick out? I mean, obviously, you're rewarded, and guys are doing it full time.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's kind of nuts where you just kind of think about that. That was nuts about that movie Comedian, where you just see Jerry Seinfeld on stage struggling with new bits.
Yeah.
Trying to figure it out. And you go, holy shit, that's exactly what I do.
Yeah.
I go on stage and I'm trying to figure it out. I'm throwing new shit out there. And, oh, that line didn't work. All right. I'll make a note to myself to go work on that joke. And that line didn't work. Try something else. I mean,
have you seen bookmarker? Have you seen Comedian lately?
Yeah, I watched it about a month ago.
That ending's pretty different,
right?
It's pretty crazy. It's pretty surreal, that ending.
Yeah,
I don't. I'm not spoiling it.
No, it's a documentary, so
it's been out for years. But Jerry Seinfeld wants to go meet his hero, Bill Cosby.
Yeah,
it's so fucking weird.
Yeah, where you watch that and you go, huh? And he's having a conversation with him.
Yeah,
and you know what? The other funny thing is that's when the whole Cosby was one of the first people that would do, rape. No, Cosby was one of the first people that would like do the whole like new hour every year.
Yeah, he was the original.
Yeah, and some people freak out about it, and then when Louis said he was going to do a new special every year, everyone's oh my god, how do you do a new hour every year? And what I tell people, because I did two different specials in 2 years, and then I had a third one ready to go, but then I got married, and that I wasn't going to plan a wedding and a third special.
Oh, no, that would have been a nightmare.
Ew.
Yeah.
So, but I generally have a new hour every year, and when people say like, "How do you do that?" It's like, well, really, to be honest with you, if you tour as much as I do, or a lot of road comics do, right? A new joke every week.
Yeah.
And it's not like write a new 10 minutes every week, but write a minute every week.
Yeah.
Or a minute and a half every week, and you'll have an hour by the end of the year. Just try new shit. This week in Omaha, I've been trying some new shit. I've been trying some new endings. I've been trying some new tags, and it slowly builds. And then as you build your act, you take out Seinfeld likened it to a baseball team. Where you have your leadoff guy, who's solid, you know, and then you got your 2 through 4. That's a power, you know. That's your. So you start off real strong. 5 through 7.
Yeah,
you know, guys, you're plugging them in. You're trying them out. You're seeing how they do, and then 8 and 9 are usually really, you know, there's some solid ones to bring up the end. So you start strong and strong.
Right,
but then as things go into slumps, as jokes stop working, you take them out, you plug new ones in, you see how they do. If they're doing well, fuck it, move them on up. Move them on up the lineup. So, yeah, it's just kind of you're constantly just throwing shit out there.
No, that's an interesting philosophy. I never thought about writing a joke a week.
Yeah, just a joke a week.
Pretty easy.
And when you think about it that way,
yeah,
not I need to write a new hour.
Right.
Just, I need to write a joke a week.
Yeah.
Just a joke a week. And you try it out and see if it works. And if it works, you build on it the next week as you're throwing your other new joke out there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? It's not crazy. Even if it's just a line. Mm-hmm. Just a line, okay, great. You're slowly adding to your set.
Yeah.
And now that Netflix is doing half hours now. With half hour specials,
I'm the only one who doesn't have a Netflix special.
Yeah, yeah. You and Andy Kindler. That's it. Yeah. Now that Netflix is doing half hours, you really have no excuse.
Yeah.
Half hour a year, a new half hour every
year.
You can do that. You know, you can do a new half hour every year, and it's not that. I mean, yeah, your superstars are still going to do your hours. Your Chris Rocks, your Amy Schumer's, your
people like that are Sebastians. You're gonna do. They're gonna do an hour. Bill Burr, Jim Jeffries. But everyone else, fuck. Neil Brennan just shot a half hour special. Chris D'Elia just shot a half hour special. And those people are killing it.
Yeah.
You know, making insane money and selling a lot of tickets and half hour special, you know? And I was talking to Neil Brennan about it because I'm like, dude, you can do another hour. And he goes, I could, but then it's tough to write. That's a lot of pressure to write that new hour again. So I just do a half hour.
Tripoli and I were talking about this. He's just saying, there's no rhyme or reason to any of this. He goes, if you got something that you want to put out that's 37 minutes, just put it out. Who gives a fuck?
Put it out.
Like, put it out on the internet. Let it find a home.
We're in the time and age where if you put out something that's good, you could literally put it on YouTube.
Yeah.
And if people watch it, great. It'll spread. You know, right now I have two specials that are on Amazon Prime, and I've been getting a lot of people watching that. You know, they did their original run on Showtime. Now they've made their run, their transition to Amazon Prime. And, I'm getting a lot of traction from Amazon Prime people. It doesn't matter. You just put it out there.
Yeah.
I mean, Brett Ernst put his special out on YouTube.
Right.
And great. People watch it because at the end of the day, when a comedian does a special, we would like to get paid for it.
Sure.
But more importantly, we just want people to see it. We want people to watch it, enjoy it, go, I really like this comedian. Let me go online. Let me look up the other stuff they do. Oh, they have past albums? I'll buy those. Oh, they're coming to my town? I'll buy a ticket. Oh, they have a podcast? I'll subscribe to it.
Yeah.
You know? That's why you do the special. The special isn't the culmination.
Yeah.
The special is the next step in keeping your brand going. Everything I do in my career is just to sell tickets.
Yeah.
That's all I want to do is sell tickets on the road. So I just want to keep getting out there and getting in the public eye and being like, hey, I'm still a thing.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
Come buy a ticket and see me.
Man, I was just thinking of the special, like when we were coming up, like Eddie Murphy, Raw, Delirious, Bill Cosby himself. I mean, those are just iconic. Yeah. And I'm afraid now that with so many comedians and so many avenues that what's really special anymore?
Hannah Gatsby. Hannah Gatsby.
She's changing comedy.
Changing comedy. You're right. To some degree, you're right. There isn't that thing anymore that's like, oh my God, the special, you know, because... Yeah, we have those specials that we can talk about where we go, that made me get into comedy. Or I remember, Eddie Murphy Raw for me was that special.
Yeah, yeah.
I watched that special so many times and just laughed my ass off every time. Didn't age well. There's certain jokes you can't tell today in that special. You know, the joke where he's talking about gay people. He doesn't use the word gay, though.
Mr. T?
He talks about a gay ambulance, and it's just a gay guy on top of the ambulance going, woo, 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 woo. Like, yeah, but he doesn't use the word gay.
I'm surprised these people haven't gone out and tried to ruin his whole fucking life.
No shit. Well, look at back in the day. He said, I hate that.
It's a weird time, man, we're living in.
It's a weird time. I don't mind... Looking like if someone's running for president, or an office, or being a politician, if you find some tweet they made and they said the N-word, okay, well maybe you don't want that guy running shit. But when you're literally going back through comedians,
I know,
and finding jokes that they made, holy shit, dude! Like that's literally our jobs.
Yeah.
Like, I even to somewhat understand a sports team. They had a little controversy because they found pitchers that had, like, that guy in the Brewers that, like, back when he was, like, 18 said.
I heard about this.
Yeah, said some N-word jokes and then got a standing ovation when he pitched next, which was weird. but I even get that to some degree. I don't think it should happen, but I get it.
Mm-hmm.
But when literally your job as a comedian is to make a joke and to like, well, do you have to do that to be funny? Yes. Because there has to be some conflict to make something funny. There has to be.
Yeah.
Because what's funny about me walking on stage and saying, oh, you want to know what I did today? I went to the store. I bought cruelty-free food. I got home. I kissed my wife. I pet my dog. And I sat down and I watched the game.
Yeah.
Hilarious. That's nothing. There's
That's my
no,
closer.
Yeah, there's no joke there.
Yeah.
So there has to be conflict. There has to be something there that is that doesn't go the way you want it to go to make a joke. And I will always defend the attempt.
Yeah.
Because we're not going to bat 1,000. Every comic is going to try to tell some jokes that aren't going to be funny sometimes.
Yeah.
And we need to be able to do that. We need to be able to try and be funny. And if we fuck up, then, oh well.
Yeah.
We'll try again. All you do as the audience is you tell us. You let us know what's not funny. Mm-hmm. Because when you don't laugh at it, we go, oh, that's not funny. I'm going to go change that.
Yeah.
But if we say something that's quote-unquote taboo or wrong, and the entire audience laughs, not groans, but laughs, I'm going to say that again. Not because I believe it, not because I want it to be true, but because I made everybody laugh, and that's my job.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I don't understand that. I really don't.
We were talking about Louis earlier today about when the Saturday Night Live, and he did that one joke. What was the joke? Was I talking to you about that?
Which one?
He about kids, like pedophiles, they must really like kids.
Oh, right. Like, fucking kids must be great.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the pedophile knows it's wrong, everyone tells him it's wrong. If he gets busted on, he goes to jail forever, and he still does it. It must be good.
Yeah, and as soon as I heard that, I know that a lot of people were offended by that and got a lot of, like, you know, backlash. But I just thought to myself, well, he went for it. He went for it on national TV.
Yeah, on national TV, on Saturday Night Live.
Yeah. So as a comic, I was like, that's what it's all about, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
You took a really fucked up situation and you're trying to make it funny.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, but that's what our job is. Our job is to do the attempt.
Mm-hmm.
Our job is to be able to try to make something funny. But also, this social media thing is just madness because, like, do you remember thoughts that you had?
Oh, yeah.
Jokes that you made when you were 18?
Oh, yeah.
Holy crap. You thought some inappropriate things. You said some inappropriate things.
I still do.
Yeah. But, like, you have a little bit more of a guidance system in your head of what's going to actually be funny. Then you just... Like there's a time where just someone saying the words poo poo and pee pee made you just crack up.
Yeah.
You know? So you had no guidance in terms of what would be funny or not. So you just said a bunch of shit and you found out that, ooh, if I say the word fuck in front of my friends, I'll get a laugh. So I'll just do that all the time. Fuck. You know? So but if there was social media back then and you could tweet stuff at age 16, 17, 18.
Oh, yeah.
That's now going to follow you the rest of your life?
Yeah.
Oh.
I didn't even think about that.
I can't even imagine. Like, I met Justin Bieber one time, and this is back when he was, I think, 19 years old. And I asked him, I go, hey, dude, can you, like, tweet that I was funny? Because it'll literally change my life. Like, it'll literally – if you tweet I'm funny, my career goes a different way. Like,
what did he say?
He said, no, I can't. I don't have access to my Twitter. And at first I was like, well, that's fucking stupid. And then I thought, oh, yeah, that makes complete sense. That makes absolute sense where a guy who's worth $150 million or whatever the hell he's worth at that time and is this important to a record company, to a label, to managers, to agents. Yeah.
Yeah,
that would make sense that you would take away that kid's Twitter so he doesn't Roseanne himself. You know what I mean? And just fuck it all up because he's 19. Of course he'd tweet some weird stuff. Of course he'd go on there and
Did he think you were funny?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. He laughed. He came in the Laugh Factory one night, and there's a photo that exists of me, Eliza Schlesinger, Brian Callen, Court McCown, and Justin Bieber and Selena Gomez.
That's hilarious.
So yeah, and it was crazy because they came in together. And no one was making fun of him because they were scared to or something. And I'm like, fuck him. He's 19. What the hell does he know? So I went on stage and told the audience, like, hey, everybody, I'm sure you guys are probably looking up there every now and then. They were up in the balcony at the Laugh Factory. Yeah, Justin Bieber and Selena Gomez are here. Hollywood's hottest lesbian couple. And they got a good laugh.
For you.
Yeah, I got a good laugh from the audience. And then Bieber talked to me afterward. As you know, I told him, man, thanks for having a good sense of humor about it. And he was cool. So, that was that night. But
who was the most famous person that you found out was a fan of yours?
Ooh. A fan?
They liked your work or whatever.
Okay.
They even knew who you were.
Well, this is a really niche person. But if you know this person, you know this person. Because now there's chefs out there that are celebrities.
Celebrity chefs.
Yeah. I've got a couple of athletes that know me that aren't athletes now, but were back in the day. Like Rod Smith and Ed McCaffrey. They were wide receivers for the Denver Broncos. They're fans of mine.
That's cool.
Christian McCaffrey is a fan of mine.
That's cool.
Yeah, so he's on the Panthers right now. He went to Stanford, was a Heisman Trophy candidate. Someone you should definitely pick up in your fantasy football draft this year. Yeah, Christian McCaffrey is a fan of mine. So, yeah, he's probably the most famous person. But there's this celebrity chef who his name is Chris Santos.
And, I've heard of him.
Yeah, he's a judge on Chopped, and he's got a bunch of restaurants. And he's a huge fan of mine to the point where I can walk into any of his restaurants, and if I text him that I'm going there, I don't pay.
That's pretty awesome.
Ridiculous. That is a hookup that everyone needs. My God.
Yeah, we got Michael Simon in Cleveland.
Yeah.
You got to become friends with him.
Yeah.
So you could eat free there.
Oh, my God. That's just ridiculous. And I've told him sometimes, like, hey, I don't mind – you know, just give me a table. Like,
yeah,
I'll pay. And then he goes, "No, you're my buddy. You're not gonna pay." So it's insane.
That's a good hookup.
Yeah, man. So that's a great hookup, especially when you want to do date night with the wife.
Yeah.
Like, ah,
I got it, honey.
I got it. You know, let's go to Santos's place. So those are my two. Yeah, those are my two celebrity fans. It's weird. I forgot about Christian McCaffrey, but then it's like, he's. Millions of people watch him on Sundays.
Yeah,
draft him in fantasy football. So, Christian McCaffrey is probably my biggest celebrity.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's weird because you think about that and you never assume that. You forget that everyone consumes entertainment.
Yeah,
to some degree, you know. Some people are on Twitch playing video games. I'm sure some athletes and actors that we think are really famous and we admire are fans of esports players. You know what I mean? Or like people that watch Twitch or comedians or whatever, that, you know, musicians. Like, people are always consuming some sort of entertainment, whether it be music, comedy, movies, whatever. So, everyone's a fan of something.
That's true. That's true. Mm-hmm. One of my biggest thrills is. And I don't know if he was being honest. I'd like to think he was.
Yeah.
Chuck D from Public Enemy.
Yes.
I gave him a copy of my album.
Bass.
Hello, can you go?
Yes.
And I sent him a message. We follow each other on Twitter. And nice. I go, hey, Chuck, did you get a chance to check out my stand-up? And he goes, yeah, you're hilarious, dude. Great job. I was like, okay.
Done.
That's all I need.
You can live off that the rest of your life.
Yeah. I was like, wow. Guy Man. Who wrote...
Yeah.
Welcome to the Terror Dome.
Oh, man. Yeah. I'm a lifelong Broncos fan, and my hero is John Elway. He's my absolute hero. He's someone.
This might not go well over in Cleveland.
Yeah. Right. Shit. I mean, no, I hate him. No. But, I got to know his son. He came to one of my shows in Denver, and I'm hoping that through that, I'll eventually get to. He's a guy where if I ever met him, I would be speechless.
I was the same with Bernie Kosar on the opposite.
Oh, Kosar, man!
It was. I mean, he came to my show. I'll show you proof.
That's your childhood, bro.
He did stand. I did stand in front of comedy in front of my hero. Like,
oh, that's crazy.
I go, this is the most out-of-body weird thing that I've ever done my entire life.
Yeah, because he still lives in Cleveland, doesn't he?
Yeah, he has a place there. He goes back and forth from Florida to Cleveland.
Sure,
but,
sure. Because he wants to be in Cleveland in winter. If you have the option.
No, it's true.
Yeah, that's awesome, man.
Yeah, here, I got the photo on my Facebook page. I'll show it to you.
Yeah, that's the thing that's nuts about this business is you get to a certain level.
It's a Cleveland improv.
There's Bernie fucking Kosar, and you're wearing a Cavs jersey.
Yeah, and I'm like a little kid, man. I'm like, I can't believe this is happening. He's like, dude, you're hilarious.
Oh, man.
I'm like, number 19, you've entertained me so much.
Dude, oh, I just forgot about this one. Do you watch pro wrestling at all? Or at all?
Yeah,
I'm
familiar. Like, I don't follow it like I used to when I was younger, but I know the world very well.
Yeah, Chris Jericho is a fan of mine.
Chris Jericho, yeah.
Which is just... What? Like, yeah. I can text him, and he'll text back.
Yeah.
And I was a huge fan of Jericho.
Jericho
was one of my dudes.
Didn't I see somewhere you're doing his cruise?
Yeah, I'm doing the Jericho cruise.
Oh, that's cool.
Where it's going to be me, Ron Funches, Sal from Impractical Jokers, and a bunch of metal bands. And,
that's awesome.
A bunch of wrestlers actually wrestling on a cruise ship, which is just... madness.
That'll be fun, man.
Yeah, it's insane that's happening.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's just one of those things where, like, I got to do the craziest job I ever had. And if you're at all a wrestling fan, you'll understand this. I got to do audience warm-up for a show that is no longer on the air. It barely ran one season. But the show was called Hulk Hogan's Wrestling with Celebrities.
That's fucking awesome.
Where celebrities got into the ring and trained. And when I use the term celebrity loosely.
Yeah. So it's like Dustin Diamond.
He was on there. That, not even joking.
I believe you.
He was on there.
He's your go-to train wreck.
Danny Bonaducci was on there.
The usual
Frank Stallone. Not even in your top three of Stallones.
Yeah.
There's Trishel from The Real World, Todd Bridges,
of course,
and the man who's keeping us from nuclear war, Dennis Rodman.
That is that's like the go-to lineup right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, it really is. Where you're like, well, they're available.
Yeah,
but I got to do the audience warm up, which was in a wrestling ring.
Yeah,
surrounded by, and then one night I was doing the taping. And fucking Hulk Hogan shows up.
Hulk Hogan, man.
And I did this thing with a buddy of mine where he would heckle me from the audience. And then I would say the thing like, oh, you think this is so easy? Come up here and you.
Yeah.
And you'd say, you try to make people laugh. And my buddy would come into the ring. We had this all worked out with security guards. And then my buddy would just try to do stand-up. He'd fail.
Yeah.
Get the crowd to boo him. Get frustrated, turn, and punch me. And I would fall back, and we'd go into a match, like an impromptu match. And I did it, and we did it in front of Hogan. And it ended with me jumping off the second rope. Not the top rope. I'm not that crazy yet. But second rope, doing a frog splash and landing on my buddy and pinning him. 1, 2, 3. Whole crowd explodes. And then we start the taping, so I go off. And then someone comes up to me and goes, hey, you want to meet Hulk Hogan? And I'm like, fuck yeah. So me and my buddy go up and we see Hogan. And Hogan goes, brother, you guys were like the Wrecking Crew out there. And I'm like, oh, our tag team name would be the Wrecking Crew. That's unbelievable. And we took a photo together. And just like you and Kosar, the joy on my face.
Of course.
Just unbridled, unfiltered joy of taking a photo with someone. You know what I mean? Like
an iconic figure in entertainment.
Yeah. Like it's something to where, you can smile for a photo after a show with people, but then you can take that photo where it's like, oh shit.
Joy's just coming out of
you. Like you can't hide the fact that you're insanely happy right now.
Yeah.
And that's what this business does, man. It's insane because it happens to everybody. I mean, look at athletes are excited to meet Drake, and then Drake's excited to meet the athletes. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like everyone's sort of cross promoting, and everyone's a fan of each other. And then once you get to a certain level, you get to kind of just you get to hang out
yeah.
with your heroes. It's really an amazing thing to be involved in this business.
It does. I mean, I've got to, I mean, meet everybody, pretty much everybody I've ever wanted to meet.
Yeah.
Pretty much everyone.
Yeah.
And it's just because of comedy's taken me there.
Right.
And
it's fucking nuts, isn't it?
Yeah.
it's crazy. And now it's funny because we're all talking about people that we're fans of and shit. And in right now, you can find people that are like, oh my God, I met the famous YouTuber.
Oh, I know.
Bitch slap 457. I mean, I can't really make fun because I freak out over pro wrestlers. But, yeah, it's just it's weird how someone can be so famous in someone's eyes.
Yeah.
And then other people don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's just that level of – it's just a different – you know, with all these avenues, the streaming services and YouTube and yeah. Vine. And it's just yeah. – I don't know. I don't even know what celebrity is anymore.
Yeah. What is celebrity?
Yeah.
Is it you made an album? Is it you made a TV show? Is it you made a movie? Is it you made a YouTube video?
Yeah.
Is it you made a quick skit on Vine? Is it you fucked a guy? Like, what's celebrity? What's
yeah.
famous? You know, it's you don't really know anymore. There's so many things. There's so many things you can be famous for that it's just kind of like. Is it a reality show? Did you get a rose on The Bachelor and now you're famous because
yeah.
of that? Like there's almost just too many celebrities. There's yeah. too many people that are famous. Like because I don't know half the rappers. I don't know now.
Oh, I know.
They're all the guys on TMZ I see that get like face tattoos. I have no idea who the fuck.
Yeah, they're always dying too. I'm like, who the fuck is that?
Yeah, and they're like, everyone's sad, and I'm like, I have no idea.
Yeah,
who the hell? He was 19 years old. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, he had a million fans. Like, I was. This is not rap, but I did a TV show back in the day on Nickelodeon, and I was starring with these two people and. I was just a guest star.
Right.
And
is that the one you did with Ariana Grande?
Thanks for spoiling the story.
Oh, goddammit. Sorry.
No, it's fine. But like I didn't know who she was, and I start talking to this, you know, pipsqueak of a woman, and I'm going, I'll look her up. I'll see what she's doing in life. And at that time,
yeah,
before all the music, she had 10 million followers on Twitter, and I was like, who the fuck? Is this bitch?
That's
like,
funny.
Who the hell? You know, I had no idea that show was popular. I didn't know what people were doing. I was on the show Sam and Cat, and that was the thing where it's like, yeah, it's like you don't know, like, and I have no idea
yeah.
who this person is.
That's so funny, man.
Yeah, it's like there's so many people now that are famous that to a whole generation where I'm just like I have no. Like
I got old quick, man.
Right?
It seems like it happened just like that. I'm
yeah.
like, I'm old.
Yeah, for me, I'm 34, and for me, it seems like in the last 2 years, I got old.
Yeah, yeah.
The last 2 years, YouTubers and rappers came out that I have no idea who the hell they are, and I'm old now.
Yeah.
My agent, do you want to know who my agent's top client is?
Who?
And this is someone who represents Doug Benson. Who represents Patton Oswalt, who represents an insane lineup of people. Just mm-hmm. if you look to see who my agent I actually has, it's crazy. His most famous person, someone named Miranda Sings.
Oh, I heard of this chick.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was...
She's a YouTuber. She sings. She had a show on Netflix called Haters Back Off. She was on Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee.
That's where I
Seinfeld.
Saw her, from Seinfeld's show.
And she's playing a character the whole time. Miranda Sings. Sells out theaters. Massive...
Is she a stand-up?
No, kind of. She does...
But she just sells tickets.
She sings and does bits and little jokes and I don't even know what she does, really, to be honest with you. And she sold like 3 shows out at the Beacon Theater in New York, which is just a massive theater. And that's his top client. And you're like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah.
And And I've met her. She's great.
Yeah.
She's sweet. She's works harder. Like, I know about her work schedule because of my connection through the agent. And, yeah, she busts her ass. And she works really hard. And it's amazing. You're just like, wow.
Yeah.
All your clients. And that's, like, that's your moneymaker. Like, if there was a fire and you had to, and you only had time to grab one client in your roster, he would run in and grab Miranda Sings.
It's so weird.
Right?
It's so weird.
We're so old.
I don't connect, man. I mean, the substance, like, there's, I mean, we grew up in an era, I mean, we'll go to even the pro wrestling. Even the pro wrestlers, like, were like Piper and Hogan,
yeah,
and
Macho
the Four Horsemen.
Yeah,
and
yeah, yeah.
Like, that, and it's just, there seems like there's just no good substance anymore.
Yeah. Well, because there's
quality.
So much. Because now, there's so much stuff out there that it's like, before you had not a lot of, like you said, not a lot of avenues to be famous or
yeah.
to or for entertainment. So the best ones more or less made it, and so the best writers were always working on, you know, the same eight shows or whatever. But now there's so much, like. There's got to be good writers that are on the CBS Star Trek show. There's got to be good writers
yeah.
that are writing sitcoms on Freeform. There's got to be good writers that are writing YouTube Red shows. Like, there's got to be, like, it's like, fuck.
Yeah.
There's some the same way comics who don't have a special feel like, damn it, everyone has a special but me. Imagine being a writer. And being like everyone's writing on a TV show except me.
Yeah, yeah, it's true.
Because damn, think about every show that's on every network. They have writers.
I know. Yeah, that's true.
And they need that. You know, they and multiple writers, multiple.
Yeah.
So you know they're employing 12 writers and on every show, and you can't be one of them.
Yeah, it's true. you know what else is out there?
What's that?
Your albums. Where can people get them?
Ah, good segue. I have two CDs and then two specials, so 4 hours of material. My albums are coming up short and hi-ho. They're available on iTunes and Amazon and all that. And then, yeah, the specials are available on Amazon. Also, you can order them from my website if you want me to sign them and send them to you. That's bradwilliamscomedy.com, along with all my tour dates. You can see when I'm coming to the aforementioned Cleveland, when I'm coming to Hilarities, or wherever you're listening to this podcast. I tour so damn much. If I'm not coming to your city, wait. I'll be there.
I said this to you. You're a great comic, and I'm not ball washing. So it was a fucking fun weekend working with you. And
yeah.
I've known about you forever. Like, you just know about people, and you finally get a chance to hang with someone. It was a lot of fun, man.
Thanks, man. It's weird how you can just kind of know people and you assume that you know them. It's like you've yeah. hung out with them.
Yeah.
You know, it's crazy.
I knew who you were. Like, I knew, oh, that's Brad Williams. Like,
yeah.
I've heard you talk on podcasts.
Yeah. I was like that with Todd Barry.
Yeah.
Todd Barry and I just kind of ran into each other and we're like, oh, yeah, we know each other. Wait, have we met? Oh, we haven't met.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Like you talk for a second, you go, oh, we haven't. Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Like, I just thought we had met at some point.
Because it really is high school. We are in high school.
We really are.
Yeah.
It's just our high school is spread all over the country.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
Instead of your class that's down the hill, you know, yeah. or on the other side of the school, it's your class in Omaha and your class in Seattle. And, oh, I got to go to this class that's in New York,
right?
You know,
exactly.
It's in, you all meet in New York or LA for homeroom.
That's a great analogy. It's at Brad Williams. Was it, what's your handle on Instagram and
oh,
Twitter?
I'll put it in the link. Yeah, at
Brad
Williams comic on Instagram, at Funny Brad on Twitter. I should really make those the same thing. So at Funny Brad on Twitter, at Brad Williams comic on Instagram. BradWilliamsComedy.com is the website where you can check everything out. The podcast is about last night. The Netflix special will be coming out this fall. I think that's it.
You got a lot going on, man.
Yeah, I got a lot going on. Yeah. We'll see. We got more and more coming. If things work out the way I'm hoping they will, I got more on the way. So so hopefully I'll have that $25 million year and then peace out.
Yeah, and I'll be hanging in at your new place.
Yeah, right.
Thanks again, Brad.
Hey.
genius. Special like fine juice, you never seen it. Internationally known, the longest and leanest. Shout out to one who's in the eyes. Hit him with the rhyme and the rhyme don't stop. Look at the beat and the beat go drop. The beat go battle, make the battle go pop. Then take a look around this spot. I'm seeing every detail, like an overcrowded camera. Sleep stacks in the back, say damn ya. You say you can't, and I say why can't ya? Chop of the track, in the land of. You wanna buy it, you wanna take it. Wanna drive it, wanna make it. You wanna buy it, you wanna pay cash. Take a look around you. You wanna buy it, you wanna take it. Wanna drive it, wanna make it. You wanna buy it, you wanna pay cash. Take a look around you. There's a burning gear. That's my DJ, and I've got the Brazier. Dropping bombs like a bombardier. I can count out. It's a chocolate seer. We're giving you a little slice of heaven. B-boys bringing it back to A7. Deal with the schism. Ride on the rhythm. Sweet like pie in the pie. Wanna give our speed to cool. And you serve your position. Cause you're like a more man. I'm on a mission. We are the invisible. Gates is lyrical. I'm a regular physical. When the moment is critical. Do you wanna ride it? Do you wanna take it? Wanna wanna try it?